কে সয়েছে কি? তামাক পাখির আওয়াজ কে সয়েছে? তুমি তো শুনতে চাই খরচরে আউ জন শুন।
हेलो, बोलो सर।
यस मैडम,
ओके, जस्ट चेक वगैरह मौजूद। हेलो,
हेलो हेलो, माइक
हाँ
चेक
नूर
से।
सर, हाँ इट इज़ ओके नूर सर।
अच्छा, जस्ट अ मिनट जस्ट। हेलो हेलो, नाउ
हाँ इट इज़ ओके नूर सर, डॉक्टर लसिता इज़
नाउ
नाउ
इट्स ऑल्सो
फॉर्मली,
ओके।
या डॉक्टर लसिता, डॉक्टर लसिता इज़ नाउ फॉर्मली स्टार्टिंग इट, इट इज़ ओके।
ओके ओके।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीबडी। तो दिस इज सेकंड डे ऑफ आवर वेबिनार सीरीज ऑन ऑल द प्रोसेस एंड ऑफबोर्डिंग प्रोसेसेस। होप यू एंजॉयड द लेक्चर यस्टरडे। टुडे पाली सर इज रेडी विद हिज प्रेजेंटेशन। विदाउट मच डिले वी विल स्टार्ट आवर प्रेजेंटेशन। Regarding the attendance form and feedback form, we need not worry about all those things. Please concentrate on the presentation. In between, I will be sending the attendance form. Feedback form will be sent at the end of the last day of the webinar, not in between. The attendance form will be circulated today without any issue. Now I invite Professor Manian sir to formally start the session.
Sure, I'll join. Okay, I'll start sharing. Welcome back. I'll start my presentation then. Hope it is visible now.
Yeah, sir, it is visible.
Yesterday, while closing my lecture, I mentioned that depending upon the manner in which metal is mobilized and scavenged from the source, transported, and then finally deposited to form ore deposit, we can categorize ore deposits broadly into three groups. One group, I said, involves magma from source to the depositional site when partial melting takes place, either in upper mantle or in lower crust, which are the source rocks. Metal is mobilized and scavenged into the magma. It is transported and then deposited in a suitable environment to form ore deposit. This is one group. Today's talk is on this group of deposits, which are called the magmatic deposits. Okay. Let me go to the next slide. These are some of the important types of magmatic deposits, okay, which I'll be discussing. I'll discuss some general characteristics of each of these deposits with more focus on their genesis, how each of these ore deposit types are formed. Meaning genesis generally includes what is the source of metal, right? How metal is mobilized and scavenged, what is the pathway and energy for movement, and what is the mechanism of ore formation at the depositional site. Right? What influences ore formation at the depositional site? This is what we try to understand while studying any mineral deposit. This is what is called ore genesis. Right? Understanding the various parameters of ore formation from source to the depositional site. Right? Some of the important deposits which are formed by magmatic process includes chromite. There are two types of chromite deposits, stratiform and polyform. All known chromite deposits are formed by magmatic process only. And lateralization can bring in some changes in the chromite ore body due to weathering. But primarily, chromite deposits are formed entirely by magmatic process. And there is a type of sulfide deposit enriched in these two metals, copper and nickel, and sometimes also enriched in platinum group of elements associated with magmetic rocks. These are generally called magmatic sulfide deposits. They are important source for copper and nickel and sometimes for platinum group of elements also. This PG mineralization is also known to be associated with some chromite deposits. PG mineralization can be there along with chromite ore body or this magmatic sulfide deposit. Both are known, more commonly in magmatic sulfides than chromite. And diamond in kimberlite, I mentioned some features of how diamond is brought from upper mantle to the surface by kimberlite magma. We'll discuss it in detail today. Right. There are some related ultramafic rocks. Kimberlite, earlier in literature, these kimberlites were called type 1, type 2 kimberlites like that. So that is obsolete now. Kimberlite is that what was earlier called kimberlite 1, type 1 kimberlite. That other type 2 is now called orangeite. There are some variants of kimberlites like lamproids, which are also known to be associated with diamond. We'll discuss mostly about kimberlite. And rare earth element mineralization in carbonatite. What is common to all this? Chromite, copper nickel sulfide, diamond, and Re in carbonatite is there. The parent magma which mobilizes these metals or diamond from upper mantle and brings it to the crust to form ore deposit. It's all derived from mantle, upper mantle. Some of these are rich in volatiles, particularly this kimberlites and carbonatite melts. They are rich in volatiles to begin with, enriched in CO2, particularly kimberlite melt is enriched in CO2 and water. The parent magma from which carbonatite is formed is essentially an alkaline magma, rich in sodium, potassium, calcium, along with CO2, like that. So these four types of deposits, they are related to generation of melt from upper mantle. There is one more category of magmatic deposits. In Bateman book, if some of you have read, this is called late magmatic deposit. Towards the fag end of magmatism, particularly granite magmatism, some ore deposits are formed in granite pegmatites. When you say pegmatite, we are referring to granite pegmatite here. So, and this granite pegmatites are generally related to some large granite plutons, which are generated by partial melting of crustal rocks. There are instances where granitic magma can also form by fractional crystallization of magma derived from upper mantle, but most often these granitic magmas, which finally produce pegmatites and these ore deposits, they are crustally derived melts. So this group of ore deposits are different from the others. That these are all mantle derived. This is derived from the crust. But all these deposits are formed, essentially during magmatic process. There is some difference in carbonatite related RE mineralization alone. People believe that hydrothermal imprint is also there in this. You should be familiar with this metals that we are talking about. Copper nickel sulfide. No, they are there in together in periodic table. Copper nickel and along with this is platinum group of elements. These six elements, yesterday also I mentioned about it: platinum, palladium, iridium, rhodium, ruthenium, osmium. These six metals also get enriched along with copper nickel in magmatic sulfide deposits, and sometimes with chromite also these are formed. And rare earth elements are these lanthanides, atomic number 57 to 71. These are 15 elements. Then yttrium and scandium. These are the RE. And this tin is one. Then there are four metals which are generally called rare metals. We talk about these are rare earth elements, RE. And these four metals are called rare metals. Actually, they are actually rarer than RE. It includes niobium, tantalum, these two, lithium, beryllium. These are lighter metals. All these four rare metals have application in nuclear industry, in nuclear power plants and so on. So AMD is interested in uranium primarily, which is the fuel, nuclear fuel, and also in niobium, tantalum, lithium, beryllium, as well as zirconium. Zirconium essentially from beach sand, but these are mostly from granite pegmatite, niobium, tantalum, lithium, beryllium. So this is one of the focus of AMD, exploration of rare metals, mostly in granite pegmatites. So we'll discuss about some general characteristics of these ore deposits and how these are formed. Let's first have a look at stratiform chromite deposits. And the stratiform chromites are large sized chromite deposits compared to podiform chromite deposits, which are relatively small. Stratiform chromites are relatively large, and they are generally part of some igneous complexes containing ultramafic rocks, are ultrabasic rocks like anorthosite, ultramafic rocks including dunite, peridotite, pyroxenite, gabbro, and so on. A diverse assemblage of igneous rocks formed from the same parent magma occur together in the complex. That's why it's called a complex. A group of igneous rocks formed from the same parent magma. And in this igneous complex, chromite is always associated with the earliest formed rocks, either anorthosite or dunite, prancitite, and so on. Because chromite is a high temperature mineral. It starts crystallizing very early along with the olivine, orthopyroxene, and the calcic plagioclase. Now, crystalline temperature of chromite is quite high. So it is always formed in the early stage of magmatic crystallization. In Batman's book, this is what is called early magmatic deposit. And pegmatitic deposits are the other extreme. They are formed in very late magmatic stage. I'll discuss about it later. Right? What is very abnormal in the case of stratiform chromite deposits is that in many complexes, these chromite layers, they continue with the consistent thickness for very long distances. No? The largest stratiform chromite deposit is associated with Bushveld igneous complex in South Africa, in Kapval Crater. There is a large, I'll show some other diagram. And these chromite layers are known to have lateral continuity with the uniform thickness for several tens of kilometers. No? Such consistent thickness is more common in sedimentary successions. No? This is an igneous complex where chromite layers show consistent thickness over very long lateral extent. Right? This is something very abnormal. Earlier people thought simple fractional crystallization of magma. Like chromite can crystallize as a fraction from magma, and because of its density, it will settle down to form layer like that. Suppose olivine, and it was thought that olivine and chromite were crystallizing from the magma in the early stage, and because chromite has a higher density, it's around 5, olivine around 3.3. This density difference could have induced separation of chromite from this olivine rich rocks like dunite or peridotite. Like that was the thinking. But if you consider the reality, chromium concentration of parent magma, calculations have been made. What was the chromium content? Like when the magma was generated by melting of upper mantle, how much chromium was available in the parent magma? These calculations have been made, considering the volume of igneous rock and volume of the chromite ore body. Right? And all these calculations show that chromium concentration at the maximum can be of the order of few thousand ppm, 0.1%, 0.2%, like that. It is a minor element. Right? So when this is a minor element, and suppose it starts crystallizing early along with olivine will be the major component that was crystallizing from magma. And the chromite will be a minor component. There is no way chromite can separate from olivine because it will be always crowded by olivine. The crystallizing phase will be dominantly olivine with few grains of chromite here and there. So chromite settling will be hindered by olivine. It cannot segregate to form layers having consistent thickness. Right? So the simple fractional crystallization model cannot explain how such chromite layers could develop in stratiform chromite deposits. So people have studied it in detail. Let's look at some background details of Bushveld igneous complex. It's a very large body having dimensions of this 460 kilometer in one direction, 330 kilometers in another. It's something approximately, let us say, the size of Kadapa basin, right? So, and this Ellipto cycloton, and calculations have been made on what was the initial concentration of chromium in the parent magma, and this abnormally high, about 5000 ppm, that's 0.5%. If you want to convert percentage to ppm, multiply by 10,000. You want to convert ppm to percentage, divide by 10,000. Right? This will be 0.5%. It's a minor element. And this Bushell igneous complex is also having giant titaniferous magnetite deposits in the upper part of the Pluto, where it is associated with gabbroic rocks. Magnetite crystallizes at relatively low temperature than chromite. So chromite crystallizes at early temperature, high temperature. So it is associated with the early formed igneous rocks, magnetite in late formed rocks, like upper zone. The cumulative thickness of this igneous complex. Now, this is the outcrop area. Cumulative thickness is of the order of 9 kilometers. And it's a huge volume of igneous rock, right? Having diverse rocks, peridotites at the bottom, pyroxenite, anorthosite. Most of the chromite ore body is associated with anorthosite. Right? Anorthosite is a relatively better candidate as a host rock for chromite because the density contrast between calcic plagioclase and chromite. Calcic plagioclase will have a density of around 2.7 gram per cc. Specific gravity, let's say 2.7. Chromite has a specific gravity of around 5.1. There is a large difference in density. So separation of chromite from a magma which is crystallizing anorthosite will be much simpler than separating olivine and chromite. Olivine density is around 3.3. Right? Chromite density is 5.1, like that. The difference in density between chromite and olivine is less compared to calcic plagioclase and chromite. Well, there are instances where chromite is hosted essentially in dunite, right? And most of the Indian deposits are of that type. Well, we have examples of anorthosite-related chromite deposit also. In that Sitamundi anorthosite complex is known to have some chromite ore bodies, not large ones. Sukinda and Bawla chromite deposits, and the chromite deposits in Nugyalicious belt. Bairapur, Tagadur, all these are associated essentially with dunite. Right? And in Bushell igneous complex, chromite is mostly associated with anorthosite. These chromite layers are called chromitite, as if it is a rock. They call it chromitite. It's dominantly made up of chromite, so it's called chromitite. Right? Although they are layers, people also use the name lode, chromite lode, like. It all refers to the same, a layer which is essentially consisting of chromite. This is a massive chromite ore. Chromite ore is always massive. And there will be minor silicates disseminated within the chromite. And in the host rock, it will be just the other way around. Suppose it is anorthosite, it is dominantly calcic plagioclase with the disseminated chromite. So just the proportion of chromite versus silicate is just reverse here and here, like that. Right? And if it is dunite and chromitite, dunite will dominantly have olivine with dispersed chromite. When this is abnormally high, 5000 ppm chromium in the parent magma is very large value. So it must have come from a source which was having a relatively higher concentration of chromium, right? And partial melting of upper mantle must have put a significant concentration of chromium into the magma, like that. Right? We'll focus only on chromite, although this is also a large magnetite deposit, and this complex also contains a magmatic sulfide deposit associated with the platinum mineralization. This is also one of the largest platinum deposits in the world. In this complex, there is a reef called Merensky Reef. Merensky Reef in Bushell igneous complex contains Copernican sulfide mineralization associated with the platinum group of elements. This is the grade of platinum group of elements. This is very high grade for PGE, 8 to 15 gram per ton. And there are a few models which have try to explain how these chromite layers could have separated from the silicate host, right? Silicate host is the dominant phase. This is a minor component which has crystallized from the magma. It is generally believed that these chromite layers would have formed in a situation where the magma was crystallizing only chromite, not silicate. Suppose, assume a situation. These are ultramafic magma or ultrabasic magma, which will form anorthosite. An ultramafic magma, instead of crystallizing silicate, it is believed that it was crystallizing chromite alone at some stage. No, silicates were not at all crystallizing at that stage. If that is the scenario, settling of chromite through ultramafic magma is a much simpler task. No, this ultramafic magma or ultrabasic magma, they have very low silica content, isn't it? Less than 45% silica. The viscosity of silicate magma is attributed to two parameters. One is silica content. If silica content is low, viscosity will be less. The reason is, I will explain when I talk about pegmatites. No? This silica forms some kind of a chain polymer in a melt. And this silicate polymers offer resistance for flow. So when more silica is there, the magma will have more viscosity. Ultrabasic magmas are low silica magma, so their viscosity is less. And viscosity is also related to temperature of magma. No, these are high temperature melts. So both because this ultramafic or ultrabasic magmas are high temperature melts and they have low silica, the viscosity of magma will be relatively less. And in a magma like this, if a high density mineral like chromite crystallizes, it will freely settle to form a layer. Right? So this is what is believed, that there were conditions during magmatic crystallization when silicates were not at all crystallizing. That is, silicate crystallization was almost completely suppressed. This is a very abnormal situation. Only when that situation happens, this separation is possible. No, it is like I often tell in my class also. Normal traffic in a road, right? There will be a lot of movement. Suppose when a VAP passes through the road, the entire traffic is stopped. The common public who frequently move through the road, they are suppressed. Their movement is suppressed. Right? And the VAP will move freely to the road without any traffic issue. And when the VAP passes, then again the normal traffic starts. It is like that. Normal traffic is like silicate crystallization. Then there's too much of crowding. When there's too much of crowding, chromite, which is the VAP here, it cannot freely settle. Suppose this crowding is not there in the magma. Chromite can settle very easily. So this is the model by which this genesis of stratiform chromite deposit is understood. How this is achieved? What can cause suppression of silicates from silicate magma? See, silicate magma is expected to crystallize silicates only. How is it possible that you suppress silicate crystallization and allow a spinel? No, chromite is a spinel oxide. No? How is it possible that spinel alone can crystallize from magma? But it is believed that it has happened, because of which these chromite layers are there. Right? Simple crystallization, fractional crystallization, in which olivine, calcic plagioclase, pyroxene are crystallizing as dominant phases from a magma, along with the small quantities of chromite. No? This chromite cannot get separated from these silicates in spite of having higher density, because this chromite settling will be hindered. If the silicates are not at all crystallizing and it is a clear liquid having low viscosity, chromite settling will be a very easy task. That is how it is believed that chromite, stratiform chromite, has formed. Now, people have done a lot of experiments to understand this. How is it possible that you stop silicate crystallization from a silicate magma? There's something abnormal. Okay? There are few conditions which could have resulted in suppression of silicates from ultramafic magma. One is this. Before I discuss, let me show. This Buschwald igneous complex has been studied extensively because this is a giant chromite deposit. This is the result of one study. I've given only some result from eastern part of the Buschwald complex and western part. The temperature of crystallization and the partial pressure of oxygen during magmatic crystallization, that it is related to oxygen fugacity. Let's say it is oxygen fugacity. Temperature and oxygen fugacity of crystallizing phases has been determined, right, based on some geochemical studies, right, of what? Chromite seam. What was the temperature of crystallization of chromite seam and what was the oxygen fugacity during crystallization of this chromite seam? That is one. And then chromite is also there in small amount in the ultramafic rock here. So chromite from the ore body and chromite from the associated rock has been studied to know what was the temperature of crystallization when this layer was being formed and when this layer was being formed. Also, what was the oxygen fugacity when this layer was formed and when this rock layer was formed. Like that. You compare, this is the data given. Okay. This is the western part. It is found the crystallization temperature of chromite in the ore body as well as in the rock is nearly same, but there is enormous difference in the oxygen fugacity. When the rock was being formed, the oxygen fugacity was relatively low, and when the chromite was crystallizing, the oxygen fugacity was relatively high, right? So it is believed because of this stratiform chromite deposits are known for cyclic layering or rhythmic layering of alternate rock ore like that, right? So this determination is the basis for the model where it is believed that when crystallization was taking place in the magma chamber, the chamber was experiencing oscillation in oxygen fugacity, fluctuation. Oxygen fugacity was fluctuating. It is some kind of a situation like this. Assume that a large crowd, now all cinema halls are closed. Assume that a cinema hall is full of viewers, audience, and all windows and doors are closed. What will happen? After some time, we all consume oxygen. Then there will be a deficit of oxygen in the air inside the hall. The oxygen fugacity goes down because we are consuming it, right? And suppose suddenly all these windows and doors are open, there will be a fresh supply of air inside, oxygen fugacity will increase like that, right? Now this is possible. So it is believed that this kind of situation has happened during magmatic crystallization. And some experimental studies were carried out on a starting material of alluvium-tholeitic basalt having 500 ppm chromium, right? And the behavior of crystallization of different minerals at various temperature and oxygen fugacity, because the purpose of this experiment was to know whether fluctuation in oxygen fugacity will influence suppression of silicates or not. And it was found that this phase diagram, you see that at 1200 degrees, right, when the oxygen fugacity is low, that is this layer, rock layer, only olivine and liquid, that is the residual melt will be there. So chromite doesn't actually crystallize. It may enter partly into olivine structure, but chromite doesn't crystallize. What happens when the oxygen fugacity is high? Only spinel and liquid, spinel in this case it is chromite, right? If the oxygen fugacity is high at the same temperature, spinel alone, chromite alone can crystallize from a silicate magma. And suppose this crystallization of spinel, it will consume oxygen and oxygen fugacity will go down. When oxygen fugacity reduces, then olivine starts crystallizing at the major phase. So if, like opening the door and window of hall periodically and closing it, if suppose this kind of situation has happened, there was a periodic influx of oxygen into the magma chamber, which is possible by assimilation of certain types of crustal rocks. After this magma was emplaced into the crust, suppose certain crustal rocks were being assimilated. Assimilation will happen because this ultramafic magma has a very high temperature. This assimilation, periodic assimilation of crustal rocks, can increase the oxygen fugacity within the whole chamber. Oxygen fugacity is one geochemical parameter which can be fairly homogeneous over a large chamber. So suppose when in a hall, if windows and doors are opened, air will enter and it will be there everywhere, not for few persons alone. The whole hall will have more or less uniform, let us say, oxygen fugacity. Right? It can diffuse easily. Right? So this kind of situation is this is one possibility. Fluctuation in the oxygen fugacity of magma chamber could have suppressed crystallization of silicates during some stages when chromite alone crystallizes to form a layer. Then oxygen fugacity then goes down, the silicates start crystallizing. Then another pulse of increased oxygen fugacity could have resulted in chromite crystallization like that. So this is one model. Fluctuation in oxygen fugacity could have suppressed silicate crystallization. Ultimately, what is common to all these models which explain the development of chromite layers is that a situation where silicate crystallization is suppressed, that is necessary to form chromite layer. This is one model. Right? There are two other models. These are from Evan's book. I hope you are able to see the bottom line now. I'll essentially explain this. Right? This is a ternary diagram of olivine, chromite, and silica. Right? And these three diagrams essentially show this part alone, right? A small part of this diagram, right? Where chromium content is extremely small. That is the natural situation. The magma will have very low chromium concentration, that this side, right? So more ultramafic here, or maybe more basic here, like this magma. So look at this diagram. I hope you can see the cursor. A magma of composition this, right? And you can see this is the field where chromite crystallizes. This is the field where olivine field, chromite field, and orthopyroxene field. And along this line, both olivine and chromite will crystallize. Here, orthopyroxene will also join. Right? So a magma of composition starting. Well, so there is a pulse of magma coming from upper mantle. It has this composition. It starts crystallizing. To start with, it will crystallize only olivine. It forms dunite. When it comes here, it starts crystallizing small quantity of chromite, which will be dispersed in silicate. It is still dunite only, right? And it keeps on moving. It is still dunite. And then pyroxene starts here. It starts crystallizing peridotite. But these are all rocks. No ore mineral, chromite, although it crystallizes, it will be dispersed in the rock. So it is essentially rock forming process. Right? Suppose after the first pulse reaches this place, suppose there is a fresh pulse of magma, second pulse of magma having same composition, A. It now enters into the magma chamber. A new pulse of magma enters into the magma chamber and it starts crystallizing olivine, then chromite joins here. I explain. It is the same diagram. The first pulse moves from A, B, C to D. It is there. Right? The second pulse comes, it starts crystallizing A, D, and it reaches E. Let's say this E. Right? Suppose this magma relatively less evolved and this more evolved magma. Suppose these two magmas mingle, right? In a magma chamber, suppose these two magmas mingle, then the mixture, no, the mixed mingled magma moves to chromite field and it starts crystallizing only chromite from here to G, F to G. F is the composition of mingled magma with mingling of E, and D pushes the composition of the magma into chromic field, F. And so it starts crystallizing. For a short spell of time, from F to G, it will crystallize only chromite. Silicate crystallization is completely suppressed here. Then it again starts crystallizing, you know, olivine, pyroxene as the major phases along with minor chromite. This is the stage when rock is formed. This is the stage when chromite layer is formed. This is one possibility. Suppose there were repeated pulses of magma entering into the magma chamber. This kind of magma mixing could have suppressed silicate crystallization during certain spell of crystallization. And at that point of time, only chromite will crystallize. This is one model, right? Mingling of magma could have suppress silicate crystallization like that. This another model where it is believed that assimilation, where it shows, this model shows that assimilation of crystal rocks into the magma chamber resulting in increase in silica content could have also suppressed silicate crystallization. Like, you know, there is a pulse of magma from A to B, it reaches some point here. Suppose some assimilation of crystal rocks takes place with an increase in silica, it will be pushed to this chromite field. Then it will start crystallizing chromite. From here to here, it will start crystallizing only chromite. And then it goes on to form dunite peridotite like that. Right? Either because of mingling of magma or increase in silica content of magma due to assimilation of crystal rock, silicate crystallization can be suppressed during magmatic crystallization. These situations will result in the formation of alternate layers of silicate rock, which can be dunite peridotite or anorthosite, and chromite, silicate rock, chromite, and so on. Now, this is a general understanding about how stratiform chromite deposits are formed. Simple fractional crystallization model cannot explain the separation of chromite from silicates, because chromite will be, you know, crowded by silicates, and its chromite settling will be hindered. It cannot settle to form a ore body like that. So the only mechanism by which this separation is possible is allow chromite alone to crystallize during some periods in the magmatic crystallization process. Okay. So this is a general understanding about how stratiform chromite deposits are formed. Right? During this process, right, when chromite alone crystallizes, if the parent magma contains significant concentration of PgE, because PgE is also sourced from upper mantle, platinum group of elements, along with chromium, nickel, PgE is also sourced from upper mantle. Right? They can occur together. In Buschel igneous complex, all are there. Chromite deposit, copper nickel sulfide with platinum, can be there. But in most of the known deposits, only chromite or copper nickel sulfides are there. In both these deposits, chromite deposits as well as copper nickel sulfide deposits, PG mineralization is known. Right? And that happens because of the same reason. When silicate crystallization is suppressed, this is the major crystallizing phase. Suppose PG crystallizes along with silicate, it would be a even minor component compared to chromite. It cannot separate in spite of having very high density of more than 20 gram per cc. No, platinum density is around 21 gram per cc compared to chromite 5. But it's an extremely small component. It will be crowded, right? But when silicate crystallization is suppressed along with chromite, PG mineralization is also possible. And you know, in India, there is one place where it is documented. In you know, out of the two large ultramafic complexes, Sukinda ultramafic complex is the large one. This is the largest chromite deposit in India. And this is the Nausahi Bola ultramafic complex. In this Nausahi ultramafic complex, there are some chromite loads where PG mineralization is proved. There are two places in India where platinum group of mineralization is known along with chromite. One is in this Nausahi ultramafic complex. Other one is in Sitamundi ultramafic complex, where GSI has proved PG mineralization along with chromite layer in anorthosite complex of Sitamundi. Right? And another character of PG mineralization in chromite association is that in chromite association, PGE form alloys. All these six metals occur in their native form with the dominance of platinum. It's an alloy, platinum alloy. Native platinum. And stratiform chromite deposits are relatively, although they are very large size deposit, they are relatively few in number in various continents. The number of stratiform chromite deposits is relatively less. Podiform chromites are more common because these podiform chromite deposits are formed along with the process by which oceanic crust is formed. In starting from mid-ocean ridge volcanism. Okay. This is where oceanic crust is formed. Oceanic crust typically has a profile with billowed basalt in the top and sheeted dike. The sheeted dikes are the pathways through which this magma was reaching the surface to produce billow basalts. So billow basalts are immediately underlined by sheeted dikes, then gabbro. And at the lowermost part, ultramafic rocks are there. Part of it is upper mantle ultramafics, part of it is lower crust ultramafic. There is a transition from crust to mantle within the ultramafic rocks. So these ultramafic rocks are in the lower part of oceanic crust. This is being generated continuously along mid-ocean ridges. And this kind of process is also known in supra subduction zone. This is mid-ocean ridge environment. This is this somewhat similar process, but it is less common. Is also known in supra subduction zone, where again rifting of oceanic crust is possible, and volcanism somewhat similar to this mid-ocean ridge volcanism, also known in some supra subduction above the subduction zone. Supra subduction zone. Oceanic crusts are also there, right? The rock assemblage which is produced in this mid-ocean ridge, typical mid-ocean ridge, are the supra subduction zone oceanic crust. It is what is called ophiolite. Of when this oceanic crust is accreted either to a outer arc or frontal arc or to a continental crust, it is called the ophiolite. As long as it lies in the seafloor, we call it oceanic crust. When it is part of continental crust or frontal arc, and when it becomes part of a landmass, that assemblage is what is called ophiolite. In ophiolites, the ultramafic components are known to be associated with chromite in some instances. And these are the podiform chromite. They don't form layers because these are formed in a more dynamic environment, where that kind of layering, it cannot have. These layered chromites are formed in a very idle or static magma chamber. It's a very dynamic environment. That kind of layered chromites do not form here. Right? The process is also a little different. It is relatively better understood because, there is no compulsion to explain how such tens of kilometer long chromites having consistent thickness are formed, you know, because they are not there. They're small, small pockets of chromite, which can develop very well by segregation from olivine and pyroxene, which also crystallize at the same temperature, right? Because these are small bodies. So this ophiolites associated with chromites are formed, you know, either here, the typical mid-ocean rich oceanic crust, or in supra-subduction zone like this. Let's look at this. This is the process by which it is believed these deposits are formed in general, that due to this upwelling below mid-ocean ridge, decompression related melting takes place in mantle, and this magma starts moving up. When the magma starts moving up, this dark portion is magma. It starts crystallizing chromite as a tail. So these are pulses of magma in this part. They start crystallizing chromite, and this chromite forms a tail for the rising pulses of magma. So these are the ones which finally form pots. So small, small pockets of chromite get segregated from the rising or ascending magma. And these ultramafic rocks are accreted in the lower part of the crust. They form the lower part of the oceanic crust. Okay. So over a period of time, there can be an accumulation of podiform chromite in the lower part of the crust. And lately, some studies have shown in the gabbroic part, due to hydrothermal alteration of gabbro, chromite mineralization is known to have taken place. I mean, if some 20 years back, if anybody had said that chromite can form by crystallization from a hydrothermal fluid, the people would not have believed. Now, some studies have actually proved chromite crystallization from hydrothermal solution is also possible to a small extent in the middle part of oceanic crust. They are known in diapsidized, I mean, this gabbro is known to have been metasomatized to more of a diapside rich rock. And so during this metasomatism, chromite crystallization has taken place in the middle part of the crust. And there are evidences, this one paper which reports such hydrothermal process. There are evidences that chromite which occurs in ultramafic rocks has undergone dissolution, and chromite has precipitated in the diapsidized zone like that. So it is believed that chromite was dissolved from ultramafic rocks and precipitated in the gabbroic rock like that. But that is a minor process. It is essentially magmatic deposit. Chromite crystallized from magma, but hydrothermal process has a limited role in chromite mineralization. People have shown that it is also possible, chromite mineralization by hydrothermal fluid. These are podiform chromite deposits. Right? We'll move on to next type. Let's see, heading six. These magmas are also generated from upper mantle, right? And one critical requirement for magmatic sulfate deposits to form. Okay, let me first discuss about this. There are two types of magmatic sulfate deposits, known as Sudbury type. Yesterday I mentioned about this, the largest nickel deposit in the world. This is associated with pluton dominated by gabbro. And people generally believe that it is related to an impact crater. And people also believe that nickel could have come from meteorite. The only instance in the world where there is a possibility that the metal which is now present in ore deposit was not taken from crustal rocks or mantle rocks, but it came from the sky, from meteorites. Okay. So that some people believe that the nickel in Sudbury, it came from meteorite, and because the pluton also has some characters of meteoric impact, later, and now it's believed that nickel also came from meteorite. Okay. But it is associated with the gabbroic pluton, which also got differentiated to more felsic rocks. But mineralization is closely associated with the gabbroic part of the pluton, gabbro. This Kambalda type is comatite associated copper nickel sulfide deposit. This type has formed, you know, comatites are known mostly in Archean and some in early protozoic time. Magnesium rich lavas of basaltic to ultra basic composition. So in some instances, these comatites are also associated with this copper nickel sulfide deposits. This is a plutonic rock, this is a volcanic rock. This is essentially gabbroic. This can have a wide range of composition, basaltic comatite to peridotitic comatite or ultra basic comatite like that. So host rock, in this case is gabbro, here it is comatite. Mineral assemblage in both these types are common. It's chalcopyrite, pyrrhotite, pentlandite, copper iron sulfide. Pyrrhotite is a non-stoichiometric mineral. You should be familiar with that. Pentlandite is also non-stoichiometric. You see that there is a deficiency of iron, vacancy in iron in this. So there is surplus cation, surplus sulfide, deficiency in iron. It's just the opposite here. Surplus metal compared to sulfur. So this is iron deficient. This is iron excess. Like both are non-stoichiometric minerals. They form together at high temperature. Pyrrhotite generally forms at high temperature. Right? Pyrite is stable, you can say, roughly up to 500 degrees centigrade. Below 500 degrees, only pyrite will crystallize, not above 500 degrees. Pyrrhotite has a overlapping temperature with pyrite. Mostly it is formed in high temperature. So these magmatic sulfide deposits are known to have this mineral assemblage. Pentlandite, pyrrhotite, chalcopyrite. So copper is in chalcopyrite, nickel in pentlandite. And wherever PG mineralization is there with magmatic sulfide deposits, they are all sulfides. Now in chromite, PG occurs in the form of alloy, native metal. But here PG occur as sulfides. These are two common sulfate minerals, cooperite and pragite. Right? So platinum and palladium, among the six metals, platinum and palladium are the dominant ones here. Right? So host rock, mineral assemblage. Let us see the process, how these magmatic sulfate deposits are formed. Again, the issue is again the same. These are minor components of the silicate magma, ultra-basic or basic magma. How then these sulfides could separate from magma to form ore deposit? That's what people have tried to understand. Because if sulfide mineralization takes place in silicate rock, all these minerals will be dispersed in the rock. It will not be a ore, it will be a rock. But in magmatic sulfide deposit, what has happened is the sulfide minerals have got separated. The way chromite got separated from silicate, the sulfide minerals, sometimes along with PG, they have got separated from silicate magma to form ore body. This is also disseminated, but there is a large scale separation of these from silicates to form a ore deposit. And this has been explained by some models. Let me also tell this. Why is it that in Archean and early protozoic time, many these deposits have formed? Many of these are, these magmatic sulfide deposits are mostly formed in Precambrian time. It is believed that the mantle contained a significant concentration of sulfur in the early stage. It was a good reservoir of sulfur. And when melting took place, the sulfur, it's a volatile element. So this magma started, taking more and more sulfur from mantle and brought it to the crust. So from mantle, much of the sulfur went to the crust. And in the crust also, what happened? It got recycled again. And when it comes near to the surface, the rocks in the oxygenated condition, sulfur will get sulfide, will get readily oxidized to sulfate, it will dissolve in water and finally go into the sea. Now we know that there's a huge concentration of sulfur in seawater. So it must have come essentially from mantle only. So through time, mantle has lost significant amount of sulfur through magmas, and then from magmas it entered into crustal rock. From crustal rock, it, most of it has gone to the sea now. Right. So when this availability of high sulfur in upper mantle was one reason why most of these deposits have formed in Archean or Protozoic time. Let's look at this model. I'm halfway through now. Other than copper, nickel, and PGE, which, you know, when magma is generated from upper mantle, these metals are mobilized and scavenged by the magma. So they are accurate. Source is upper mantle. This is not enough. The magma also should have relatively high concentration of sulfur to begin with. Right? And if such a sulfur-enriched magma undergoes crystallization, look at this diagram. When this magma having relatively high sulfur, this is no sulfide, this is 100% sulfide. No, this kind of magmas are not there. No? A silicate magma can have few 8% of sulfur, that itself is a high amount. Right? Magma cannot dissolve large concentration of sulfur. Solubility of volatile in any magma is influenced by certain parameters. In this case, at high temperature, magma can dissolve a significant amount of sulfur. So there was enough sulfur in Archean and early Protozoic time in the mantle, and magma was generated from mantle, it carried enough sulfur also, along with copper, nickel and PG. So as the magma started crystallizing, it attained sulfur saturation. Simple silicate crystallization and drop in temperature can lead to separation of a silicate melt into two liquids, a silicate melt plus sulfide melt. If the silicate magma gets saturated in sulfur in the early stage of magmatic crystallization, then a silicate melt and sulfide melt will get separated. When this liquid immiscibility, this is liquid immiscibility, it's something like, suppose a hot soup. It will be a homogeneous liquid. You allow the soup to cool, a fatty layer floats on the top. It's liquid. The fatty layer is also liquid. Water is also liquid. But with the drop in temperature, there is some liquid immiscibility. The fatty layer separates from layer. Why does it float on water? Because of its lower density. More or less similar thing happens here. When liquid immiscibility happens, a sulfide melt separates from silicate melt. When the sulfide melt separates, these are all strongly chalcophile elements, including PG, copper, nickel, and PG. They are strongly chalcophile elements. They have affinity for sulfide. They tend to develop covalent bond with sulfur minerals, sulfides. Right? So they are chalcophile metals. They are also pulled into sulfide melt. When sulfide melt separates, the melt pulls the whole copper, nickel and PG that is available in the magma. This is how these metals get concentrated into the sulfide melt. The sulfide melt will be a small fraction of silicate melt. Right? Like when a soup cools, you put a thin layer of fat in the top, which is also liquid. Bulk of it is water, like that. So in this case, the sulfide melt will not float, it will sink. Because all these are heavier elements, copper, nickel, PG, and sulfur itself. Compared to silicate, sulfide melt will have a high density. When it is loaded with these metals, it becomes even more denser. It sinks. So liquid immiscibility followed by separation of sulfide melt. Separation means it goes down. Right? If it happens in the early stage of magmatic crystallization, this sulfide melt gets separated from silicate melt, then silicate melt will start crystallizing to form chromatite or gabbro. and sulfide melt crystallizes to form this mineral assemblage, chalcopyrite, pyrrhotite, pentlandite, and if it is enriched in Pg, it will also form these minerals like that, right? And this is the critical stage, saturation of sulfur in early stage of magmatic crystallization. This can happen because of a cooling of magma. As the magma enters into the crust and it starts crystallizing, its temperature can go down. Simple cooling also can induce separation of sulfide melt. And some experimental studies, this system involving this FeO, FeS, Fe2S, FeS, and I'm sorry, trilite. It's not a stable phase. FeO, FeS, and silica. In this diagram, what is it? One liquid, two liquid. This field is two liquid field. Right? So these are high silica cases. That is not the kind of magma we are talking about. We are talking about ultramafic or basic magma. Right? So to start with, it can be a homogeneous silicate melt, which starts crystallizing. Suppose this magma enters into the crust and it assimilates some crustal rocks, because of which the silica content increases. Sudden increase in silica content of this magma can also push it into the two liquid field. When silica content increases in the magma, sulfur gets saturated because of increase in silica content. A sulfide melt can separate from silicate melt. And that sulfide melt carries all these metals along with it. And the two crystallize independently. Silicate melt forms igneous rock, sulfide melt forms ore body, like that. So either due to simple cooling or due to increase in silica content as a result of assimilation of crystal rocks, this liquid immiscibility of, separation of a sulfide melt due to liquid immiscibility could have happened, right? So it is believed that this is how these magmatic sulfide deposits are formed, in some membrane. Let me briefly explain this. This is a Kambalda type carbonical sulfide deposit. Kambalda is in Australia. In India, although in Dharwa Craton, komatiites are there in all the Dharwa type schist belts. So far, this type of presence of this type of deposit is not known. GSA has reported some mineralization in some place, not of deposit scale. Kambalda is a large nickel deposit. That's a type for this type. This is associated with komatiite flows. These are all pillowed basalt. Pillowed basalts are formed in submarine environment. Okay? So it is found that during some flows, this sulfur saturation has taken place, resulting in the separation of sulfide melt to the bottom of the pillow to produce sulfide ore body like that. Not all pillows are known to have this. So they are associated with some flows. Some of the flows are known to be associated with this mineralization. This is a popular textbook, Magmatic Sulfide Deposits, NELRAT. In Sudbury, it is essentially a pluton. The people believe that it's impact crater, which induced melting of rocks, and this dominantly composed of gabbro, and the ore body is in the lower part of this pluton. So here again, it is believed that the sulfide melt got separated from the mafic magma in the early stage because of liquid immiscibility and crystallized the ore body. And as I said, this is one instance where people believe that nickel could have come from the meteorite. Okay? These are magmatic sulfide deposits. Let me move on. Okay, maybe we can have discussion toward the end. No, let me complete and then you can keep posting your queries. We'll discuss it at the end. That will be better. Kimberlite, as I said, is one host for primary diamond. And what we now understand is that diamond is a xenocrist in kimberlite. It did not crystallize. Earlier, people thought that diamond crystallized from kimberlite magma. The way olivine pyroxene crystallized, people thought diamond also crystallized. Okay? That is fair, then nothing wrong in that. Only when radiometric ages were available, for diamond and the host rock, the picture became clear. The diamond is much older than the kimberlite. So then the understanding changed, and people have tried to understand, how this diamond has been brought in solid state from mantle depth to the surface. So that's the focus of this understanding genesis of diamond in kimberlite, how it was possible to bring diamond from mantle depth to the surface by this kimberlite magma. Kimberlite magma has some abnormal composition compared to the previous magmas which I discussed. They are normal mafic, ultramafic magmas. Right? Kimberlite magma is also ultrabasic magma like others which you discussed earlier, but it contains high potassium. And more than that, it is a volatile rich magma having relatively high CO2 and water concentration. How do we know this? Kimberlite contains, other than the aluminum, there are some special type of pyroxenes. Chrome diopside, chromium rich diopside is common. No? Aluminum pyroxene, other than aluminum pyroxene, this kimberlite contains among minerals which crystallize from the magma. Igneous mineral, I'm talking alumine, chrome dioxide, and phlogopite, magnesium rich mica. Phlogopite, all micas are potassium bearing minerals. Right? Let me quickly use this. K, Mg3. This K is always there, potassium. Mg3. This is for phlogopite, I'm writing. AlSi, aluminum is also needed for this. AlSi3, O10. This is the sheet. AlSi3 O10 is the sheet, phyllosilicate structure. The sheets are bonded with the these two cations, monovalent and divalent here, and OH twice. Hydroxyl ions are interstitial to the structure. This is phlogopite. You put iron here, this is 2+. You put Fe2 plus here, that is biotite. Instead of 3 Mg or 3 Fe's, you put Al2, that is muscovite. And you put some lithium along with aluminum, that is lepidolite. Right? So this is phlogopite. All micas contain potassium and water. Presence of phlogopite as an essential mineral of kimberlite is a clear indication. Let me go to full screen. This is a potassic magma, contain enough water. Then calcite is also a common, it's not secondary mineral, it has crystallized from magma. So that magma was carrying enough CO2 as well as water. This is how this magma is different. So volatile rich magma having high this potassium content. Actually, solubility of CO2 in a magma is essentially influenced by alkali like sodium and potassium. Alkaline magma can dissolve more water. Because this kimberlite magma contains more potassium, it could dissolve CO2 also. This CO2 has a very critical role in the ascent of kimberlite magma, which I will discuss. Right? So this is unusual from the normal ultramafic magmas, which produce dunite, peridotite, like that. This is also a kind of peridotite, but it has some other minerals, which are normally not there in ultramafic rocks, phlogopite, calcite, and the diopside is also chromium rich, chrome diopside. And besides all this, I'll show later this. Xenocris and xenoliths are very common in kimberlite. This is the only igneous rock which is known to carry on an average 25% by volume xenolith. 75% of this rock represent the product of crystallization from kimberlite magma. 25% is the load that it carried along the path. It pulls mantle rocks, crustal rocks along the path and carries them along there. No? Xenolith. Xenoliths are common in all igneous rocks, but not to this proportion. Right? 1/4 of the rock on an average is xenolith. This is something unusual for this magma. And that this also related to the process by which kimberlite is formed. Right? So mantle xenolith, another important, other than its importance for diamond, these kimberlites are also important for the fact that they have brought mantle xenoliths from 150 to 200 kilometers surface. These are the depths where we could never reach by putting borehole. The deepest borehole that has ever been drilled is around 12 kilometer depth in Kola Peninsula in northern part of Russia. We cannot go directly beneath the earth. Below 12, we could not go below 12 kilometers. This kimberlite has come from more than 150 kilometers depth, bringing mantle rocks to the surface. So it's a reservoir of mantle xenolith, other than diamond. And it also brings, other than these mantle xenoliths, mantle crystals like garnets are also brought along with them. Okay. Let's look into some features. Now, how do we know that this, diamond is a xenocrystalline kimberlite, that it did not crystallize from magma, but it was picked up by the magma as a crystal. This evidence comes essentially from the age of diamond. This age of diamond is measured from inclusion, silicate inclusion. And this is the age of host rock. Except in one case where the difference is marginal, you can see in all these cases, mostly in South Africa and other regions, diamond is much older than the kimberlite. So diamond was already there and it was brought up by the magma. This is the age of emplacement or crystallization of kimberlite. Right? So this is how we understand that the diamond is a xenocrystal. And there are some intricacies about this. If the magma was ascent, there are two things. The magma had to pass through about 150 kilometers or more through upper mantle and crust. It's a long journey through rigid rocks. There is a lot of difficulty in there. And then the ascent has to be very rapid to preserve diamond. If the magma emplacement was slow, which is the case with most of the magmas, particularly granitic magma, which has a high viscosity. Magma ascent is a, magma emplacement is a slow process generally. But kimberlite emplacement, with that kind of ascent, the entire diamond would have got transformed into graphite. So the fact that diamonds are preserved in kimberlite clearly show that the magma has risen very rapidly. So these are the two critical issues about the kimberlite magma design. How we could travel through such a long path from upper mantle to crust, and how it could travel so rapidly so that it has preserved diamond. These are the issues people have tried to understand. Let me skip this one. So it is believed that the kimberlite magma was generated from a metasomatized mantle, a mantle which was already enriched in volatiles, CO2, H2. So when melting took place, this magma carried enough of this volatiles like that. And this is the diamond stability field below this depth. This is the continental crust, let's say shield. And the diamond stability field lies at, shortest depth below shield areas. And the depth at which diamond stability field occurs below oceanic crust is much greater. And this is one of the reasons why most of the kimberlites are associated with the shield areas. Diamond stability field occurs at a relatively shorter depth, about 160 kilometers or so, you can see. So it is believed that in some parts of mantle which had already undergone metasomatism, this diamond exists. Diamond doesn't exist everywhere. In metasomatized mantle, at depths more than 160 kilometer, PT conditions are such that diamond can form. and it is stable there. This diamond stability field. Above that, it will occur as graphite. The graphite stability field, diamond stability. So in order to pick up diamond, the kimberlite magma needs to be generated below the diamond stability field or within the diamond stability field. So the magma is generated here and picks up diamond and reaches the surface. Kimberlite is a volcanic rock. Although the lava part of kimberlite is nowhere preserved in the kimberlite, we see only the pipe conduit part. The lava part, ultrabasic rock, it gets weathered easily. So lava part of kimberlite is not preserved anywhere. It is only that that pipe which is preserved, right, through which the lava reached the surface. Right? So broadly, this is how it has happened. From diamond stability field, the magma has risen to the surface, and it picked up diamond, and it also picked up rocks of mantle and other minerals which are. This magma comes from garnet stability field. Let me just show this alone. It passes through a garnet lherzolite. With that, there is a peridotite where garnet is there. Garnet can occur in a wide range of depth, and spinel at shallow depth, spinel plus garnet at shallow depth, and garnet at deeper level. The spinel, it is not stable in the deeper part. Right? This all, within a depth of, let's say, 200 kilometers in the upper mantle. So it passes through mantle rocks which contain garnet. That garnet, it is mostly pyrope garnet, because mantle is magnesium rich, and this garnet is also magnesium rich, pyrope garnet. It also picks up pyrope garnet. Pyrope garnet is a very common xenocrist. The way it picks up diamond, it picks up garnet also. Right? Garnet from a wide range of depth. Garnet from garnet lherzolite field and garnet from spinel garnet lherzolite field. Right? It is found that the composition of garnet, pyrope garnet, varies systematically with the depth. That chromium content of this pyrope garnet is relatively high. Chromium is not a constituent element. Chromium content is high and calcium content is low. Calcium is also not a constituent element. Right? But calcium substitutes for magnesium and chromium substitutes for iron. Right? And so this chromium content is high in the deeper part of mantle in garnet, and the calcium content is high in the shallower part from that spinel garnet lherzolite. Okay? So people have categorized garnet in this entire depth range of mantle into 10 categories, the way Mohs scale of hardness is designed, G10. Garnet, G9, G8, G7, like that, up to G1. G10 garnet lies in the diamond stability field. The composition of G10 garnet has been characterized. So this is the G10 garnet field. So when a kimberlite contains G10 garnet having a particular composition, it has a specific color also. You would search sometimes in Google, G10 garnet. It's a beautiful pink colored garnet. So G10 garnet, presence of G10 garnet in a kimberlite is an indication that this magma started its journey from diamond stability field. It is an exploration tool for locating diamond bearing kimberlite. Not all kimberlite pipes contain diamond. Suppose a kimberlite magma was generated from graphite stability field and it moved to that. There's no way it can have diamond, because it started its journey from graphite stability field. So in order to have diamond, it should have started its journey from diamond stability field. One indicator for that is presence of G10 garnet. Right? This is one part of that. That the magma was generated from diamond stability field. The most critical issue is, how did this magma find its way to the surface very quickly? And a lot of experimental studies have been done. I think I'll move fast. This is a sample of this. Of course, these are rare. Large xenocrysts are rare. This is xenocrysts of garnet, pair of garnet. They are rare, no? We have few samples of kimberlite. This microliths and microcrist, small sized foreign particles, they are more common than larger ones, right? And this is due to the explosive nature of this volcanism, which has broken, you know, all minerals into small, small pieces. This is a relatively rare one. And it is believed that diamond also must have been broken into number of pieces. What we see now, that was not the original size of the diamond. So in mantle, diamond crystals must have been fairly large sized one. So during the ascent, the rapid ascent, due to explosive nature of this volcanism, so all these mineral fragments and rock fragments are broken into tiny pieces. Microcrysts or microliths are more common than large sized ones. If you see anytime granite, no, the xenoliths will be some tens of centimeter or few centimeter large. Those type of xenoliths are rare in kimberlite. They are mostly broken into small pieces, right? And it is believed that, let me be quick, some experimental studies have been done on this. No? There is one work, you know, which shows, this is published in Science, where people have estimated that this kimberlite magma took just 1 hour to pierce through this 150 kilometer depth to reach the surface. Suppose you are standing here, right? And after 1 hour, suddenly you see there was a volcanic eruption like that, right? No, no, that kind of very rapid event can preserve, it can result in preservation of diamond in kimberlite magma. And there are other estimates that even, you know, other estimates also show it could have taken 1 or 2 days like that. 150 kilometers within few days or within few hours like that. It's a very rapid ascent. How is it possible? Some experimental studies have been done on that. It is believed that when this magma was ascending, it interacted with the peridotite containing orthopyroxene. This orthopyroxene gets dissolved in magma. The kimberlite magma picks up xenoliths containing orthopyroxene. This orthopyroxene can dissolve in kimberlite magma. Dissolution of orthopyroxene in the magma will increase the silica content of the magma. As the silica content increases, CO2 is released from the magma. CO2 was dissolved in the magma. With increasing silica content, because of this, CO2 started bubbling. Like, you know, when milk starts bubbling, boiling, suddenly rises. Why does it rise so rapidly? The bulk density of the milk suddenly drops because of bubbling. So it develops a buoyancy and rises rapidly. That kind of incident is believed to have happened here. Bubbling of CO2 due to dissolution of orthopyroxene in kimberlite magma is believed to have provided such a great energy that this magma could rise rapidly through the whole of upper mantle and crust to reach the surface like that. And in this process, all these xenoliths were broken into very tiny pieces. And because of rapid ascent, diamond was preserved like that. Right? This is the model that many people have proposed to understand the genesis of diamond in kimberlite. Okay? We'll move on. It's 25. There are certain alkaline rocks which are known to be associated with RE mineralization. There are two types of alkaline rocks, in alkaline complexes. This, like ultramafic complexes, the alkaline rocks also form complex with the variety of rocks. Igneous rocks form from the same parent magma. There are two possibilities. This may have only alkaline rocks like cyanide, nepheline cyanide, some pyroxenite, dunite is also possible. Okay? There are some alkaline complexes which have only silicate rocks. There are some in which towards the late stage, a carbonatite melt was also generated. due to liquid immiscibility from silicate melt, more or less like the way sulfide melt gets separated from silicate melt. A carbonatite melt is believed to have separated from alkaline magma when there was CO2 saturation. Carbonatite, it takes place in the late stage. There are some alkaline complexes which are associated with carbonatites. Now, alkaline rocks in general, both, they contain the highest known concentration of Re compared to all other rocks. Alkaline rocks contain relatively higher Re. Carbonatites are known to have the highest concentration of Re. Whether there is a mineralization or not, the average concentration of Re in carbonatite is highest among all the rocks that are known. Right? So it clearly shows that this magma had a source for Re, and Re has been enriched during magmatic crystallization. That the last product, carbonatite is, in wherever carbonatite is there in an alkaline complex, this is always the last rock to form. And it can crystallize among, you know, all magmas that are known to us. This is the only one which completes its crystallization at temperature as low as 400 degrees or so. And this is also the only magma whose viscosity is very low, because it doesn't have silica. Carbonatite melt is known for its very low viscosity. That is why it flows easily through rocks to form dikes. Right? And so that this magma had a source derived from upper mantle for Re, and Re has got enriched during magmatic crystallization, resulting in the formation of carbonatite. Right? And carbonate, yesterday I talked about ligand. If you see the table sometime, I found this talk is available in YouTube. And you can see the Pearson's table in literature. See that Re and carbonate, Re is on the acid side, carbonate is in the base side. So this carbonate is a good ligand for Re. So Re has been transported by carbonate. It has been enriched in the last stage of magmatism when carbonatite crystallized. And at that stage, the Re concentration also increased. And the viscosity of the magma was so low that Re could diffuse through the melt to form its own mineral. Like that, right? So this is also a magmatic process. So there is some difference between kimberlite magma and this alkaline magma, but there is also some similarity. Both, like kimberlite magma is ultrapotassic, that is also alkaline. This alkaline magma is also ultrapotassic. It is also alkaline, not necessarily potassium. It carries significant concentration of sodium calcium also, right? This is also alkaline. And because of high alkalinity, this magma has the capacity to dissolve more CO2. Right? But it is believed that this is also generated from a metasomatized mantle where alkalis were there, CO2 was available, and all these incompatible elements were also enriched in the metasomatized mantle. That was the source. So there is some subtle difference between the source from where kimberlite magma is generated and the source from where this alkaline magma, which produces carbonatite, is generated. And so this magma has moved up to the crust, and during fractional crystallization, number of alkaline rocks are formed. Cyanide, nepheline cyanide. This alkaline complexes are known to have an exotic assemblage of minerals, very large diversity of minerals. Many of these are unique to alkaline rocks. And during fractional crystallization, finally, when this carbonatite dikes are formed, it is believed that Re concentration reached a level where these elements could form their own minerals. This bastnasite is a very common Re mineral, which is associated with this carbonatite. It's a cerium carbonate fluoride. Cerium is 3+, CO3 is 2-, F is 1-. Cerium carbonate fluoride. And others are also known. The most common ore mineral is bastnasite. Right? In the world, the largest Re deposit is in the northern part of China. It's a giant Re deposit, Bayanobo. Right? And this is the reason China has a monopoly in RE production and supply. Let's move on. I'd like to complete in another 10 minutes so that we can have enough time for discussion. Just one moment. Unlike the earlier types of deposits which I discussed previously, the metal and the magma come from upper mantle, right? And these pegmatitic deposits are associated with granite. They are late stage products. The way you can say, let me make a comparison. This carbonatite is the late stage product of alkaline magmatism. You can say, these pegmatites are late stage products of granite magmatism. They are the youngest rocks to form. And briefly tell this, water plays an important role in the formation of pegmatic deposits. When a silicate magma gets saturated with water, that magma is the pegmatitic magma. A water-saturated silicate magma is the pegmatitic magma. When the magma gets saturated in water, this silicate chain in the magma, when it dissolves more and more water, these are water molecules, strongly polar. This water molecule breaks the silicate chain. One OH is attached here, one OH. Then this dissolution of water in silicate magma breaks this silicate chain and lowers the viscosity. So this water-saturated silicate magma will have very low viscosity. And that is why pegmatites always form dikes, because of that low viscosity. And it is attributed to this. Water molecule breaks the chain. Right? And you can see, if silicate magma contains more silica, it can accommodate more water. That is the reason granitic magma can dissolve more water. In granitic magma, this each one is a SiO4 tetrahedron. More silicates are there, more water can be accommodated in the structure. And higher the pressure, if the pressure is high, ambient pressure is high, a magma can dissolve more water. Higher pressure means magma generation in the lower crust, where the pressure will be high. But both due to the influence of high pressure and high silica content, granitic magma can dissolve more water in that. Right? To start with, so this is also shown in this diagram. Let me skip that. This explains why granitic magma can dissolve more water. So let's look at two situations. A granitic magma having 1% water to start with and 5% water to start with, and it starts crystallizing. What will granitic magma crystallize? It will crystallize alkali feldspar and quartz. Very less, maybe biotite, muscovite, amphibole. Then let's say they are negligible. Essentially, it crystallizes anhydrous phases, quartz feldspar. Right? So as it starts crystallizing anhydrous phases, this what is shown here is percentage of crystallized phases. So 20% of magma is crystallized, 80% is the residual melt. Here, 40% of magma has crystallized, 60% is the residual melt. No? As the magma crystallizes anhydrous phases, the water content of residual melt will gradually increase. And at some stage, the magma gets water saturated. The solubility of water in silicate magma, as I said, is influenced by silica content and pressure. Okay? So magmatic crystallization very often leads to a situation where a magma gets saturated in water. If the initial water content of the magma, granitic magma, is low, it gets water saturated after, let's say, nearly 90% of the magma is crystallized. 10% is the residual melt. Right? That is the water saturated residual melt. That water saturated residual melt is the pegmatitic melt. So during crystallization of granitic magma of this composition, 1% initial water, 90% granite will form, 10% granitic pegmatite melt will be formed, which will form pegmatite. Suppose the initial water content is high. It gets water saturated quite early. Large volume of pegmatitic melt will still be there. So large number of pegmatite dikes are formed. You know, where large number of pegmatites are there, they are called swarm, dike swarm. Right? If you see dike swarms of pegmatites in an area, you understand that the initial water content of the magma was high. This is the background about pegmatite. Let's look at some other, how this pegmatite ends up enriched in some of the metals which form ore deposits in pegmatites. Let's look at that. Before that, let me also briefly tell, there are two contrasting types of pegmatites. This is Pushkala, she is in AMD. This is a simple pegmatite. This is in Belkapahar area. You see that this is few meter thick. These are relatively thin. What is common to both is that from wall to core, there is a uniform texture in the pegmatite. Mineral assemblage and texture is in it. It is believed this whole melt was injected in one go into the fracture and it crystallized to form a pegmatite. It's called simple pegmatite. So this is from a temple flooring in Lodhi Road, Delhi. So I'm showing this just as a sample. You see this is not a simple pegmatite. You see this was the early component. And the early component got fractured further and it has been intruded by a later component. You see a textural difference between this and this. Right? So this is a small sample of complex pegmatite. In the field, this complex, this results from multiple injection of pegmatitic melt along the same fracture. This simple pegmatite indicates an instance where magma emplacement took place through a fracture at just one go. Complex pegmatites are formed by repeated fracturing and filling along the same fracture system. Multiple injections. Right? The later injections will be more and more evolved in their composition. Evolved in the sense it will have more and more water, right? It will have more of incompatible elements. Right? Complex pegmatites are generally mineralized, not simple pegmatites. What happens? Let us look at some of these deposits. This granite is a good source for all these metals, lithium, beryllium and also niobium tantalum to some extent. This one. Right? Lithium, these are all lithium minerals, beryllium and sometimes niobium tantalum also. All these are incompatible elements. In the sense, these elements find it difficult. They are all trace elements. You know, the crystal abundance of all these elements except lithium, which can be in tens of ppm. These are present in few ppm or ppb level in crystal rock, very low concentration. Right? So they cannot form their own minerals in rocks normally. Right? And their ionic size and charge is such that they don't fit into rock forming minerals also easily. So they are incompatible. Right? Like niobium tantalum, they are pentavalent. There is no rock forming mineral which has a pentavalent cation. Silicon titanium, they are tetravalent. Isn't it? This has pentavalent, but still it can be accommodated in titanium. But there is a large difference in ionic size. So it will not fit into titanium readily. There is some substitution between niobium tantalum and titanium. Beryllium, the problem is it's a divalent cation. Very small in size compared to calcium, magnesium. The size of beryllium is too small. It cannot occupy the place of calcium in rock forming minerals. So it is incompatible. It is true for lithium also. This lithium is a relatively large sized ion. It cannot normally substitute for sodium potassium. So these are all incompatible metals. Right? And granitic magma is a good source for these metals. So because of their incompatibility, when granitic magma crystallizes, these metals do not enter into rock forming mineral. They remain always in the residual melt. Right? And these pegmatites are formed in the last stage. Right? These are the last stage products of granite magmatism. So this incompatible metals like beryllium, lithium, niobium, tantalum, they always remain in the residual melt because they don't readily enter into the structure of rock forming minerals. The rock forming minerals do not allow them to enter into the structure because of incompatibility. They remain in the residual melt. So the, over a period of time, the concentration of these metals increases in the residue. The pegmatitic melt will have relatively high concentration of this compared to granitic magma. Pegmatitic melt will have higher concentration. And another issue is that the pegmatitic melt has a very low viscosity compared to granitic magma. Higher concentration of these metals and low viscosity of the medium, the melt, these elements are able to get together to form their own minerals. They don't enter into rock forming, they form their own minerals like beryllium form beryl, niobium tantalum form columbate tantalite, and lithium can form variety of minerals. It can form, I showed you the composition of plagiopite. Everything else is same except that in this place you have lithium and aluminum. If only aluminum is there, it is muscovite. Put some lithium, then this proportion is slightly changed to accommodate lithium here, and it is lepidolite. Lepidolite is a complex mineral extracting, and then it has relatively less lithium than spodumene and amblygonite. Extracting lithium from spodumene, spodumene is an alkali pyroxene, like jadeite. Jadeite is NaAlSiO6, this is LaAlSiO6. Amblygonite is a phosphate. These two are important ore minerals for lithium because the lithium concentration is relatively high and it is easy to extract lithium from this. Lithium, you know the use, no? This is one of the metals which has the greatest demand now. Every one of us have more than one mobile phone. All our electronic devices have lithium ion batteries. Where from we will get so much lithium, right? But this is not the only source. The major source of lithium is players in some countries like Bolivia. From rhyolite, which contains relatively high lithium, this lithium was leached by surface water or the magmatic water which was being discharged by the volcano, and it entered into lake sediments as players. Right? We have players in Rajasthan, that Sambar Lake, like that. In those players also, AMD is looking for it. That is hot cake for lithium. There it doesn't form this mineral. There lithium is available in a very simple form. Right? But as mineral, these are important ore minerals for lithium, spodumene and amblygonite rather than lepidolite. Right? Beryllium has application in nuclear industry and niobium tantalum also. These incompatible elements get enriched in the late stage of granite magmatism, and particularly where we find complex pegmatite. Complex pegmatites indicates a situation where the pegmatitic melt was continuously being injected in pulses. So the last pulse will have more water, less viscosity, and it will get enriched in these metals. Right? So therefore, the complex pegmatites are generally associated with this rare metal. So they, AMD calls this rare metal pegmatites. Rare metal pegmatites are those which are associated with one or more of this lithium, beryllium, and niobium tantalum. Okay, there is one special situation. This will be my last discussion. Right? Beryl can form in a complex pegmatite. Right, and sometimes. No, there are instances where this granite pegmatite intrudes into an ultra basic rock like peridotite or dunite. It's a water charged melt. When this water rich melt intrudes into a peridotite, peridotite is one rock which is highly reactive with water. Serpentinization is very common in peridotite. It can happen in wide range of temperature. Right? So when a water saturated granitic melt, that pegmatitic melt intrudes into a pegmatite, that alluvium gets serpentinized, and during serpentinization, as I said yesterday, when the host structure changes, new silicate to serpentine, phyllosilicate, trace concentration of chromium, which is hosted in alluvium structure, is thrown out. And beryl comes from granitic pegmatite, and at this interface between this pegmatite and ultrabasic rock, where you have a supply of chromium coming from ultramafic rock, beryllium coming from granitic magma, emerald is formed. It's also beryl with trace chromium in the structure. This is, you know, it gives a beautiful green color. Chromium as a trace element enters into beryl, it can substitute for Al3+ in small concentration. That's good enough to give a brilliant green color for beryl. So that is how beryl is formed. Wherever these granite pegmatites intrude into peridotite, and this pegmatite had enough concentration of beryllium, beryl is formed. Emerald is formed. Beryl may be there inside, no? Emerald at the interface like that. This is how beryl, emerald deposits are formed in granite pegmatite. It is the same beryl which has incorporated chromium in the structure. This will be my last slide, then we can have enough discussion. Let me quickly review this. There are some critical parameters in the formation of each type of magmatic deposit in chromite, and this critical parameter is mostly linked to some volatile. In chromite, it's the oxygen fugacity. Increase in oxygen fugacity can suppress silicate crystallization. It has a critical role. And of course, there are also other models where mingling of magma can suppress silicate crystallization. But in general, it is believed that fluctuation in oxygen fugacity played a dominant role in suppression of silicate crystallization. So this volatile. What about copper nickel PG sulfide deposits? Sulfur saturation. No, sulfur plays a critical role. No, when the magma carries high concentration of sulfur, sulfur saturation at the early stage of magmatic crystallization takes place, resulting in separation of sulfide milk. This is a critical parameter. In diamond, CO2 bubbling. Right? The CO2, which was dissolved in kimberlite magma, started bubbling as orthopyroxene was gradually assimilated in the kimberlite magma. Silica content of magma increased. And see, as I said, no, this solubility of CO2 in magma is essentially a function of alkali content. More alkali, more CO2 content. When silica content increases, naturally, you know, alkali concentration will decrease proportionately. So CO2 is expelled. That CO2 bubbling gave sufficient energy to lift the kimberlite magma rapidly to the surface, preserving diamond. So CO2 has played a role. And also in carbonatite-related alkaline magmatism. CO2 saturation in the late stage of magmatic crystallization is responsible for carbonatite formation, and RE mineralization takes place in carbonatite because this carbonate carries RE, and when a carbonatite melt is formed, it has a very low viscosity and it can crystallize over a long period of time, up to 400 degrees or so. So during progressive crystallization, at some stage, RE mineralization takes place, like CO2. And pegmatite deposits, water saturation plays an important role. Right? So in all these magmatic deposits, apart from the metals, right, some other chemical parameter has played a critical role in ore formation. Like that. With this, I'll close now. I will stop presentation, and Dr. Nurul can pose questions, can answer. Dr. Nurul, yes, please. My audio was clear, Dr. Nurul?
Yeah, it was clear.
Okay.
Today, there are few questions.
Okay, fine.
So one student, Darius and Hassan, they have asked, what is the major difference between kimberlite and lamproite?
It is essentially the relative proportion of volatiles. Like, kimberlite magma is one which has more CO2 and less water. This lamprite and orangeites are a variant of this magma where there is more water and less CO2. So it reflects in the mineral assemblage. That main difference is in the proportion of volatiles. Kimberlite magma is typically CO2 dominant with less water. So today there are very less participants, so the question is also proportionately less.
Yeah. Another attendant here has asked, what is the difference between E type diamond and P type diamond?
I don't know which, what exactly is referring to. Is referring to the clarity. I'm not sure about that. If he is referring to, let me assume that he is referring to clarity of diamond. This commercially people talk about inclusion size in diamond. VVF, very, very fine. If the mineral inclusion in diamond, the diamond always contains inclusion. Diamond, it's not, there is not a single diamond which is not known to have mineral inclusion. And these mineral inclusions have helped to date them also. Right? When the mineral inclusion is very, very fine, diamond will have a perfect clarity. This mineral inclusion will hinder in the internal reflection. So if internal reflection is not hindered, the diamond will be brilliant. When the inclusions are very, very fine, diamond becomes very expensive. And inclusion size gradually increases, then they say VFF like that. If you can, you are able to see inclusion in a mineral with your eye, that diamond will be, very cheap like that. Maybe I'm not sure whether he's talking about EEC like that. So in commercial,
I think he is confused about the types of magmas and diamond maybe. And there is another question, now one has asked, this is, one student is asking, is there any difference in properties of diamondiferous kimberlite and non-diamondiferous kimberlite?
As I said, not many kimberlites carry diamond, right? Like in Indian context, the Majgaon kimberlite field and the Hinota kimberlite field in Vindhyan Basin, they are all diamondiferous. This Lattavaram and Vajrakarur in eastern Dharwakatan, they also contain diamond, right? But there is a newly discovered, recently discovered diamond field, Narayanpet kimberlite field. More than 30 pipes have been discovered by GSI. Not a single pipe is known to have diamond. They are barren. The main reason for this could be that the kimberlite started its journey from graphite stability field. And one tool for distinguishing this is the presence or absence of G10 garnet. Because diamond, although we say diamond bearing garnet, kimberlite, it's a very rare mineral in kimberlite. The grade, yesterday we talked about grade, some metals occur in percentage level, some occur in gram per ton level. Diamond potential in kimberlite is graded like this. 20 carat per 100 ton is a kimberlite which can be mined for diamond. 20 carat is 20 multiplied by 200 milligram. That is how much? 4 gram. 4 gram of diamond in 100 tons of kimberlite. This is the grade of kimberlite, right? So diamond is very rare in kimberlite. Even when a pipe contains diamond, it's extremely rare. But garnet is a very common mineral. So garnet acts as a tool, exploration tool. If G10 garnet having that high chromium content and low calcium content is present, it gives an indication that the kimberlite started its journey from diamond stability field, then there is a potential for diamond like that. That is one of the tools that people use.
Another question. Maybe Dr. Bhutani can.
Yes.
He has asked, one student has asked about the techniques of dating of diamond. Is it possible to date diamond?
already answered this question.
I think you are not audible.
Is it audible now? Or?
Yes, better now.
Okay, so I think Professor Pandian has already answered this question during his presentation, that diamonds can be dated using the inclusions within them. Diamonds themselves are not dated, but the small inclusions which are present, they are dated. And some people have even found the sulfide inclusions where rhenium osmium system is used. So you have to have some inclusion which can be dated. So those are always present. And I think Professor Pandian has already answered this question. Isn't it, sir? Isn't it?
You are right, Professor Rajneesh. Yes.
Sir, another question, I think that is too specific. One gentleman asks about particularly the genesis of a chromite deposit somewhere in Andhra. So I don't remember now, that comment is not coming. So I think it is difficult to answer the specific things. One has to do research and study.
Okay. It will fit into one of the two types, stratiform or podiform, depending upon what is the rock association and what is the form of ore body.
I think there are no more questions.
Fine. Okay. We have made it to time today. 7.
Sir, there is one question Pragya has asked, that is there any Sadbury type magmatic sulfide deposits available in India?
Which type?
She is specifically asking whether Sadbury type magmatic sulfide deposits are present in India.
Copper nickel sulfide mineralization has been reported from many ultramafic and mafic terrains. Mineralization. Till date, there is no copper nickel sulfide deposit proved anywhere in India. Right? This magmatic sulfide deposits which contain copper and nickel, whether it is Sudbury type. Now people are looking for that Kambalda type in Dharwarkhattan, where comatites are there, but it's not known till now. Right? So the nickel associated with this magmatic sulfate deposit is generally considered as a primary source, formed primarily. No? And the other source for nickel is lateritization of ultramafic rocks, particularly ophiolites. There are a number of ophiolite belts in Philippines, Java, Sumatra, Indonesia, and all these islands. They are in tropical region, which receives good rainfall. Lateritization takes place extensively. There are ophiolites exposed extensively in those regions. When these ultra basic rocks of ophiolite, they undergo lateritization, nickel is released from ultra basic rock, is concentrated in laterite to form some green colored mineral called garnierite, or it also gets enriched in limonite horizon light. That is called secondary nickel, lateritic nickel deposit. Right? So they are known in India. In Sukinda ultramafic complex, there is a lateritic cover which is proved to have a lateritic nickel deposit. But there is no primary nickel deposit in India, Sudbury type or Kambalda type, they are not known.
Sir, an interesting question has come up. One student, I think Anand Rajoria, he asks specifically that Panna diamond mine is occurring, it is producing diamond for so many years. So what is the, how these are formed?
There are groups of kimberlite pipes. One of the oldest mine is at Majgaon pipe. No? So mining, these are, you remember, government mines will work at its own pace. They will do mining to produce the domestic need of the country, right? Fortunately, this Panna diamond mines, they are all government. NMDC is working there. If it was a private mine, your question, you would not have asked this question. There are no more, they would have excavated kimberlite to the maximum possible depth, and like the way Agucha deposit is being mined, right?
I think his question is about, the diamondiferous conglomerates of the Indians from how they have formed. Probably that he's asking
That is secondary. When the kimberlite is weathered, the diamond enters into these sediments, and this diamond bearing conglomerates are there in Kadapa Basin also. That Kohinoor diamond is believed to have come from some of the kimberlite pipes outside Kadapa Basin. Banganapalli conglomerate of this Srisailam, the uppermost group of Kadapa super group, Srisailam. It has a conglomerate horizon called Banganapalli conglomerate. That is also diamond bearing. Vindhyan, there are horizons which are diamond bearing. They are secondary. They came from kimberlite. That is a lesser source. Important source is kimberlite.
Sir, then some questions are coming in. He is asking, why there are no diamond occurrences associated with Deccan volcanics?
How do you expect Deccan volcanics to have diamond? Unless there is this Deccan volcanism, the magma generation is a very shallow process. Drift-related magmatism or the plume, the plume-related magmatism. That plume may not have come from a deeper, it is not a pipe in any case, right? And the main difference is the kimberlite pipes, they form due to very rapid ascent of the magma so that it could preserve a diamond. This Deccan volcanism, maybe Professor Rajneesh will know that the ascent of magma was not such a rapid process. And it's not a deep-seated magma source that it could have brought diamond. In any case, it was not a rapid event of volcanic eruption, the way kimberlites are formed.
He's asking that possibility of magmatic formation of, the possibility of formation of magmatic ore deposits are more in oceanic plate or in continental plate?
It depends on which type of ore deposit. So if you are referring to chromite deposit, right? It is associated with the ultramafic rock of ultramafic component of oceanic crust. Cannot generalize like that. So like all granite magmatism related ore deposits, they are part of continental crust. Kimberlites are known mostly in shield areas where the lithospheric thickness is relatively less. So the magma could easily reach the surface, compared to oceanic crust. Oceanic crust also, in subduction zone also, kimberlite volcanism is known. But diamond potential is highest in shield areas where kimberlite pipes have intruded. So they have specific association. Oceanic crust, it has produced only podiform chromite in the lower part of oceanic crust, not other deposits.
Okay, then there is a question regarding this thing. He is asking, whether all alkaline magmatism produce carbonatitic rocks or not? This is a basic question from igneous petrology. He's asking whether all kind of alkali magmatism are associated with carbonatite or not.
Very few are associated with carbonatite. Maybe that CO2 saturation plays a critical role. And so it needs that magma should have sourced a very high concentration of CO2 to start with. And the general model about carbonatite that I understand, that Leyba work, that a kind of silicate carbonate immiscibility took place because of CO2 saturation, and the carbonatite melt separated. But it doesn't always have. There are large number of alkaline complexes without carbonatite. Professor Rajneesh will know better. Rajneesh wants to say.
That's what it is actually.
All the alkaline magmatism may not have carbonatites, right?
Yes.
In specific context only it will form.
Yes.
I think that is all.
Okay.
So again, that Sachin Thakur is asking, I mean, that Anubhav Sinha. So whether most of the ore deposits are oceanic or continental, it cannot be generalized. So in a specific situation only it will form. Sir has already answered that. Some people are querying about the exploration process of diamond. I mean, how diamond are explored?
This is a very difficult task. Only advantage with this kimberlite pipe is it's related to volcanism, so it is exposed to the surface. Unless it is covered by a sedimentary sequence, it is there on the surface. But the difficult part is the outcrop area of kimberlite. It is measured in acres. Acre, where do we use this unit? Agriculture field, isn't it? The outcrop area of kimberlite is generally so small that we talk about 10 acre, 20 acre like that. 20 acre is a good sized kimberlite pipe. No, to locate such a small object on the earth surface is a very difficult task, right? So it is the expertise of geologists that makes a difference.
I think that will be all, I mean, questions. There okay. are two more questions.
You can then stop. Professor Rajneesh, you can close the session. Or Dr. Lasita, if she wants to make announcement.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I think it was a very comprehensive and very informative session. And I'm seeing, looking at the comments, everybody is so happy to have this particular talk from you. Thank you very much. May I ask Dr. Lasita if you have any announcement to make related to the feedback form and attendance? People are asking a lot of things from
that. Yeah, that I have already mentioned in the chat box.
Okay, so I think they are a little confused between the attendance form and the feedback form.
Yeah, I think the problem is that there is some problem in pasting the link in the YouTube chat box.
Yeah.
So finally, we could do that. So people might have.
Yeah, now I can see that this attendance link has already been pasted in the YouTube. And the overall feedback form would be circulated on the last day. That is to get the feedback on the webinar series. And this particular attendance link has already been pasted in both Google Meet as well as in the YouTube. So they can use it now. That's all, no? Okay, thank you then. Thank you, Professor Pandian sir, again. And thank you, Dr. Nurul, for the moderation of asking the question. Thank you, Dr. Lasita. All of us would meet again around 4:45 tomorrow, and we will start the third talk of the series at 5 sharp. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ganpati, maybe you can end the meeting now.
Yes, sir. Sir, yes, sir.
Yes, please. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ganapati. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.